All righty. 1 Corinthians chapter 11. My hope is we're going to finish up 1 Corinthians chapter 11. As I mentioned when we began this chapter, navigating through it is a challenge. There's some interesting and difficult things that we're dealing with. And I know that there are a number of different views, especially in regards to the section that we're covering, commonly referred to as the Lord's Supper. And I'm well aware of the fact that there are differing views and different ways of taking the passage. So I don't claim to have a grasp of all that's happening in this section, the latter section here in chapter 11. And I do want to, again, emphasize that I have the utmost respect for those brothers that might have a differing understanding regarding the so-called Lord's Supper, okay? But we're going to look at some language that tends to be difficult and maybe uncomfortable. And there are eight expressions that are on the dry erase board back here on the chalkboard that can cause a lot of problems in light of the, quote, Lord's Supper. So let's begin reading here, chapter 11, verse 27, okay? Verse 27, "Wherefore, whosoever shall eat this bread and drink this cup of the Lord unworthily shall be guilty of the body and blood of the Lord Jesus. But let a man examine himself, and so let him eat of that bread and drink of that cup. For he that eateth and drinketh unworthily eateth and drinketh damnation to himself, not discerning the Lord's body. For this cause many are weak and sickly among you, and many sleep. For if we would judge ourselves, we should not be judged. But when we are judged, we are chastened of the Lord, that we should not be condemned with the world. Wherefore, my brethren, when ye come together to eat, tarry one for another. And if any man hunger, let him eat at home, that ye come not together unto condemnation. And the rest will I set in order when I come." So we're going to tackle some of these expressions or some of these words. We saw last time, 2 weeks ago, some things regarding showing the Lord's death. We'll review that very, very quickly here. Then we see the word drinking and eating unworthily. There's the issue of being guilty of the body and blood and being guilty of the Lord's body. Then Paul talks about damnation. Paul refers to those who are weak, sickly, and sleep. Then Paul talks about being judged and not being judged. Then Paul makes a reference to being chastened, and then Paul makes reference to condemnation. And depending on how you view this section of 1 Corinthians 11, we're going to come to differing conclusions, okay? I mentioned a couple of weeks ago that there are dear friends of ours that take verses 26 through following from verses 26 down through at least verse 29. As referring to Judas, there is an element that believe that what the Lord Jesus Christ is doing by revealing this information to the Apostle Paul, what's happening is Paul now learns that the events in the upper room, the events surrounding this supper that the Lord Jesus Christ had with his 12 disciples or apostles, that what's happening in the upper room is now revealed to the Apostle Paul and delivered to the Corinthians so that we would learn we're not supposed to be doing it. And you will at times hear that what this section is doing is describing Judas and how it is that Judas is the one who, for example, verse 27, he drank and ate unworthily. And as a result, it was Judas who is guilty of the body and blood of the Lord. We read in verse 29 that, for example, it was Judas who, again, ate and drank unworthily. And as a result, it was Judas who drank damnation to himself. And that is a way of handling the verse. I'm not convinced that that's what's happening here, that this section is not describing Judas's unworthiness and Judas's guilt and Judas's damnation and ultimately Judas being condemned. For me, again, when we recognize the context, I think that it's a safer route to go. When we look at the immediate context and certainly the broader context, I think that this language that we're looking at this morning is going to fit a little bit better. Even though the language might be a bit uncomfortable, remember this. This is language that Paul does use in his epistles, okay? So when we see the word damnation or condemnation or chastening or judging, this isn't the first time we find this language in Paul's epistles, okay? Paul does use this language in other places. For me, I would rather try to understand the language in this section based upon what the Apostle Paul says about it. For me, that would be a better way of understanding what this language is conveying, okay? So for me, I'm going to stick to what the Apostle Paul has to say regarding damnation, regarding condemnation, regarding being guilty, so on and so forth, okay? So that's the approach that I'm taking, and for me, it works, okay? We did already spend time looking at the issue of type versus antitype. And is Paul in this section establishing a ceremony? Is he establishing some sort of ritual, for lack of a better word, where we are literally engaged in eating bread or a cracker and literally drinking from a cup, be it grape juice or wine? Or is the focus on the, quote, antitype? That is, what does the bread represent? What does the cup represent? And for me, the issue here is the antitype. It isn't the physical bread or the physical cup, but rather what it truly does represent. The bread representing, first of all, the body of Jesus Christ. But the bread, according to chapter 10, representing the communion, the common union that the body of Christ enjoys one with each other, okay? So if we recognize the true spiritual meaning, the spiritual reality, then I can better understand the language that Paul is going to be using. So if we once again notice there at verse 28, but let a man examine himself, and so let him eat of, notice, that bread and drink of what? That cup, the antitype, the real bread and the real cup, not the type that is the figure or the shadow represented by literal bread or a literal cup, okay? So with that said, we did last time, if you notice verse 26, for as often as ye eat this bread and drink this cup, ye do show the Lord's death till he come. Question, how does the body of Christ today show the Lord's death? And how do you show the Lord's death? By eating a cracker or drinking grape juice. Again, understanding the context, when we recognize, go back to chapter 10, that there is this figure, this shadow, if you will, 1 Corinthians chapter 10, and notice verse 16, the cup of blessing which we bless, is it not the communion of the blood of Christ? Always remember, common union. The bread which we break, is it not the communion, the common union of the what? Body of Christ. So there's the reality, okay? Verse 17, for we being many are one bread and one body, for we are all partakers of that one bread. For me, that's the reality. That's the issue. That's the thrust. That's the heart of what's happening here in 1 Corinthians chapter 11, something that the Corinthians are guilty of violating. The Corinthians are violating the common union. They're violating this relationship that exists as one bread. They're violating the blessing that the cup represents. And that's why Paul's rebuking them and supplying corrective doctrine. By the way, side note, when Paul's talking about being judged, that's exactly what Paul is doing here. Paul is judging the Corinthians, and he's chastening them by providing corrective doctrine, okay? So we're going to appreciate the reality, the spiritual truth, the spiritual identity that we enjoy. We're the one bread, okay? Well, what's happening at Corinth? They are completely violating the spirit and the essence of what is true and real of them. There isn't common union. There is what? Division. There is, sadly, fragmentation. There is polarization. There is isolation. That is contrary to what it means to be one bread and to enjoy the blessing of the one cup. So if that's true, in what sense then does the body of Christ show forth the Lord's death? Verse 26. Well, how do we do it? Do you show the Lord's death by eating an oyster cracker and drinking Welch's grape juice? Or is there a spiritual meaning behind showing the Lord's death in light of the common union that exists among us? I believe there is. We go to real quickly, go to Ephesians chapter 5. We looked at this, I think, a little more closely a couple of weeks ago. Just again, a reminder in light of these eight terms that we're going to be examining here. Ephesians chapter 5. We actually do show the Lord's death by the way we relate to one another, by the way we minister one to another. I'm not showing the Lord's death by eating bread. I'm showing the Lord's death by engaging myself in a level of ministry and selfless sacrificial service to my brothers and my sisters in whom I have common union with. For example, Ephesians chapter 5, verse 1, "Be ye therefore followers of God as dear children and walk in love, as Christ also hath loved us and hath given himself for us an offering and a sacrifice to God for a sweet-smelling savor." How did the Lord Jesus Christ exemplify love? For the study on Thursday, you know how you, hopefully you're always learning. And I know I used to always say that the love of God transcends human love. And then you got to be careful with that language, because some people, they, in describing the transcendency of God, what they're suggesting is that the type of love that God has is separate and distinct from the creature's love. And that's silliness. Wait a minute. Can you love? Can you get angry? Can you be jealous? Can you change your mind? You know, those are attributes that God possesses. Can God get angry? Can God be jealous? He says, "I'm a jealous God." Can God change his mind? He says, "I repented." Can God love? Absolutely. So perhaps we ought to use a little bit better language. Instead of suggesting that God is detached from the creature and that God possesses a type or level of love that as human beings we can never comprehend, that's a bunch of baloney. God created Adam in the image of who? In the likeness of who? So God instilled into humanity some attributes that reflect who he is. In other words, when the Bible talks about loving, this isn't some strange transcendent type. I understand what love is. Now, sin corrupts it. Sin has polluted love. A better way of saying it is God's love is perfect. Human love tends not to be perfect. It's tainted by the corruptive effects of sin. But to say that his love is detached and transcendent from anything a human being can exist, that's really not true. That's bad language. Anyway, what am I getting at? How are we supposed to love, as verse 2 tells us, and walk in love as Christ also loved us and hath given himself, willingly, selflessly, surrendering himself for us, an offering and a sacrifice to God? There's a difference between an offering and a sacrifice. The free will offering. Jesus Christ gifted himself in love. And how did he do it? He gave himself an offering and a sacrifice. Did he show his death for the needy? Did Jesus Christ manifest and exemplify his love by way of dying? You know how Jesus showed his love? He died. And guess what we're privileged to do? Walk in love. How? Just like he gave himself. So I know how the body of Christ can show the Lord's death. When we adopt the same disposition, the same mental attitude that Jesus Christ possessed, I show and you can show the Lord's death when we willingly engage in selfless, sacrificial ministry, service, and lifestyle for our brothers in Christ. You see the common union? And we'll see, go to Philippians chapter 2. Philippians chapter 2. So, I'm not sure how you, quote, show his death by eating an oyster cracker. But I do know how I can show his death to my fellow members of this bread called the body of Christ. And that is, how about I serve you? Are the Corinthians serving each other? They're serving themselves. Every man taketh before others his own supper. That's not the Lord's supper. That's the Corinthian supper. That's a selfish supper. That's a carnal supper. And as a result, you have those that are being shamed. And we're going to talk about that in just a few minutes. Philippians chapter 2. Look there at verse 3. Let nothing be done through strife or vain glory, but in lowliness of mind, let each esteem other better than themselves. Look not every man on his own things. Don't get in the front of the line and don't gorge yourself at the meal at the expense of those that don't have. Okay? So, wait a minute. Let every man look not every man on his own things, but every man also on the things of others. Verse 5, let this mind be in you, which was also in Christ Jesus, who being in the form of God, thought it not robbery to be equal with God, but made himself. Interesting. He did something that was contrary to nature. He made himself. Serving one another is contrary to our inner man instincts. It isn't always natural to, quote, serve one another. But wait a minute. In Christ, in living, loving, eternal union in the person of our Lord Jesus Christ, through whom we are in living, loving, eternal union, one with each other, one bread. Okay, well, I can make myself something that I think I naturally possess. Jesus Christ in verse 7, but made himself of no reputation and took upon him the form. See, that's an act of the will, by the way. To take upon him the form of a what? See, are the Corinthians reflecting this? Are the Corinthians exemplifying the spirit and the essence of this lowliness of mind whereupon you value, honor, and esteem others before self? Corinthians are diametrically opposed to that kind of a spirit. And, the end of verse 7, was made in the likeness of men, verse 8, and being found in fashion as a man, he humbled himself and became obedient unto death, even the death of the cross. You know what we do when we adopt that same mindset? When I willingly choose to violate what I believe is naturally mine, I now make myself a servant to you and a servant to you. And I take upon myself the form of a servant. And I will obey even unto death. Now, what does Paul mean by that? Go to Colossians chapter 3. Philippians chapter 3. Philippians chapter 3. Notice in Philippians chapter 3, verse 10, that I may know him and the power of his resurrection and the fellowship of his sufferings, being made conformable unto what? His death. Is Paul seeking to show forth the Lord's death when he says, I want to be conformable? I want to be in union
and I want my life to literally be a show of death. In what way? Selfless, sacrificial service towards others. And that's exactly what he does. Go to 2 Corinthians chapter 4. 2 Corinthians chapter 4. So again, in light of the context there in 1 Corinthians chapter 11, when we recognize, value, and appreciate who we are as one bread, absolutely, we can show the Lord's death in the way we treat one another. Now notice how Paul writes in 2 Corinthians chapter 4, verse 10, always bearing about in the body, in his physical body, the dying of the Lord Jesus, that the life also of Jesus might be made manifest in our body. For we which live are always delivered unto death for Jesus' sake, that the life also of Jesus might be made manifest in our mortal flesh. So then death worketh in us. But life, what death? The death of Christ. In what way? Wow. Paul is showing forth the Lord's death by way of willingly engaging in a work of ministry that conferred upon him tremendous abuse, persecution, and suffering. So is Paul showing forth the Lord's death? Yeah. And in light of that, look at verse 15. For all things, that's the sufferings that Paul's referring to, and certainly it all begins there at verse 8. We are troubled on every side, yet not distressed. We are perplexed, but not in despair. Persecuted, but not forsaken. Cast down, but not destroyed. And by doing that, he's bearing in his body the dying. He's showing forth the Lord's death. So verse 15, for all things are for your sakes, that the abundant grace might through the thanksgiving of many. You see, the Corinthians ought to have been, and they were thankful and grateful for this display of divine death, which is exemplified through this human agent called the Apostle Paul. He's showing forth the Lord's death. He's willing to go through all of that so that he can get that saving gospel to the Corinthians and edify them on a proper foundation, and it redounds to the glory of Almighty God. I'm not quite sure how an oyster cracker redounds to the glory of God or Welch's grape juice. And I'm not trying to criticize or belittle anybody. But see, when Paul talks about showing the Lord's death, he does have a great deal to say about it. And it has everything to do with ministry, esteeming and valuing those that are unesteemable and valueless, because that's the measure of the love of Christ, okay? So enough with the showing the Lord's death. Go back to 1 Corinthians chapter 11. 1 Corinthians chapter 11. To me, I want to be the reality. I want the spiritual essence and the spiritual truth. I want to show the Lord's death in my attitude, in my language, and in my behavior towards others, especially the member of the body of Christ. 1 Corinthians, chapter 11, and let's move on here, verse 27. Wherefore, whosoever shall eat this bread and drink this cup of the Lord unworthily. Now, okay, unworthily. And again, religious tradition sadly will oppress the believer today, and they fabricate all sorts of ideas that, oh, listen, if you sit there, receive the bread, and you receive the cup, and you have unconfessed sin, or you've sinned against your brother, and all of a sudden you have these ideas about what it means to eat or to drink unworthily, and you got to make sure you're clean of any sin, and you got to make sure your relationship is right with the Lord and your relationship is right with one another. How can you sit there with the assembly and partake in this little meal when you harbor ill will to the guy sitting right next to you? That's unworthily. Well, who says that that's what Paul's talking about? Paul, he's already demonstrated you Corinthians are behaving in a very unworthy manner. It falls short of the expectations that grace imposes upon the body of Christ. Their behavior falls short of the expectations of the Lord Jesus Christ in relationship to His church and to His body. If you glance back there at chapter 11 and notice verse 17. Now, in this that I declare unto you, I praise you not, that ye come together not for the better, but for the what? The worse. Paul's already communicating what you're doing is very unworthy of who you are and unworthy of what Jesus Christ has made us. So Paul's already laying out their unworthy behavior. It's not an accurate reflection of the mind of Christ. Drop down to verse 20. When ye come together, therefore, into one place, this is not to eat the Lord's Supper. For in eating, every one taketh before other his own supper, and one is hungry, and another is drunken. Hey, is this a worthy way of treating each other? You see what Paul's doing here? He's demonstrating in what way they're eating and drinking unworthily. They're violating the spirit and the essence. Verse 22, what? Have ye not houses to eat and to drink in? Or despise ye the church of God? It isn't very worthy if you harbor animosity, or your behavior would suggest, or if your behavior literally would reflect an attitude of spite. Or despise ye the church of God, and shame them that have not. What shall I say unto you? Shall I praise you in this? I praise you not. Yeah, that's pretty unworthy, their behavior. And if you drop down to verse 34, verse 29. For he that eateth and drinketh unworthily eateth and drinketh damnation to himself, not discerning. That's unworthy. You know, before we actually engage one another, we need to be discerning in how we behave. And the Corinthians were violating that. So in other words, Paul is already telling us that to eat and to drink unworthily has everything to do with their behavior, the manner in which they're treating one another. There's nothing about unconfessed sin or an unrepentant heart or harboring. The context, it's safest to just let the context tell us what Paul's talking about, all right? And I'm going to let Paul define all this terminology, all right? So now notice something here. Verse 27, wherefore, whosoever shall eat this bread and drink this cup of the Lord unworthily, now notice, shall be guilty of the body and blood of the Lord. Look at verse 29. For he that eateth and drinketh unworthily eateth and drinketh damnation to himself, not discerning the Lord's body. So we have this unworthiness in verse 27, and then we have this unworthiness in verse 29. In verse 27, to eat and to drink unworthily results in guilt. In verse 29, to do it unworthily results in damnation. Now, everybody reacts to the word damnation. And we'll see in just a second, damnation is not limited to somebody experiencing the torment of the lake of fire forever. The word damnation is used that way. But Paul doesn't use it that way. So again, we don't need to go outside of Paul's epistles to try to define some of this language. So in what way, verse 27, wherefore whosoever shall eat this bread and drink this cup of the Lord unworthily shall be guilty of the body and blood of the Lord. So think about that now for our brothers who insist that's a description of Judas. Was Judas guilty of betraying Jesus Christ, resulting in, of course, his death? Yeah, he's guilty of that. What does it mean to be guilty of the body and blood of the Lord in keeping with the contextual spirit of what Paul is addressing here in chapter 11? And I know something about, quote, the body and the blood. If we go to Ephesians chapter 2. Now, we already know what Paul said in chapter 10 of 1 Corinthians regarding the bread. okay, of the body. The Lord's body is a reference to us. Not discerning the Lord's body, their behavior, they weren't taking others into consideration. They weren't with a view of esteem, valuing others. They were their behavior was unworthy of the Lord's body, what it means to be members of this one body, the church, the body of Christ. How can a member of the body be guilty of the blood? In Ephesians chapter 2, if you notice, in Ephesians chapter 2, and look there at verse 13, Ephesians chapter 2, verse 13. And notice here, but now in Christ Jesus, ye who sometimes were far off are made nigh by the blood, made nigh by the blood of Christ. Now, I want you to understand what in verses 11 and verse 12, Paul is dealing with a dispensational division. The Corinthians were guilty of division, carnal behavior, extolling and esteeming other self before others and so on and so forth. But there was historically one of the greatest divisions of all time. And that's the division between circumcision and uncircumcision, verse 11, between Jew and Gentile. And Paul provides the details, verse 12, that at that time ye were without Christ, being aliens from the commonwealth of Israel, strangers from the covenants of promise, having no hope, and without God in the world. But now, in Christ Jesus, ye who sometimes were far off are made nigh by the blood of Christ, for he is our peace. That's dispensational peace, not individual peace. Dispensationally speaking, when the Lord actually erected a middle wall of partition and he affirmed the division by way of circumcision and the covenants and so on and so forth, God did build a wall. In the context, it's the middle wall of partition. And the reason God built a wall was to deliberately exclude all the nations of the world. God said, "You, Israel, will not be reckoned among them." God told Israel in Leviticus, you are separate. You are my holy people. You are distinct from all the other. Is that a division? Not only did God say there is a division, he erected a wall. How are you going to get over the wall? You can't. So, verse 14, he, Christ, is our. Who's the our? Peace. Who hath made both. Who are the both? One. Wait a minute. He is our. Jew and Gentile now can have peace. The wall's gone. Only grace can take that wall down. It wasn't your legal efforts. It wasn't Israel's legal efforts. By the grace of God, God tore the wall down. And he now, verse 14, he is our peace who hath made both one and hath broken down the middle wall of partition between us, having abolished in his flesh the enmity. Listen, the hatred. There was not warm, fuzzy feelings between circumcision and uncircumcision. Remember King David? And he walks up to Goliath and he didn't say, "Oh, poor Gentile." He said, "You uncircumcised what? Dog! How dare this uncircumcised dog threaten God's people?" And of course, he picked up a stone. That's hilarious. Well, not hilarious in the sense. Listen, the strong arm of the Lord. Here's my point. There was enmity between who? Circumcision and uncircumcision. But what did the blood of Jesus Christ achieve, according to verse 13. Ye who sometimes were far off are made nigh by the what? Wait a minute. Do we understand there is this level of dispensational union and unity between two opposing factions that harbored enmity and animosity historically, verse 15 again, having abolished in his flesh the enmity, even the law of commandments contained in ordinances, for to make in himself of twain one new man, so making what? Listen, the Corinthians are violating a very important truth here. When they're out there, and we'll go to a couple of the verses here, they're not expressing a unity that the blood achieves. How can a member of the body of Christ be unworthily guilty of the blood of Jesus? By denying the peace that Jesus Christ secured through his blood in making of twain one new man. When Paul writes to the Corinthians, he calls it a new creature. And you know why Paul writes about the new creature? Dispensationally, we understand there's a context, but the Corinthians are violating the new creature truth. And we'll see that in just a second. So I know how I could be guilty of the blood when I, again, I treat others as though there is still a wall of enmity when God says the blood secures peace. Verse 16, and that he might reconcile both unto God in one body. One what? What body is this referring to? The church, the body of Christ. Go over to Colossians chapter 1. And Paul, he reaffirms this truth. Colossians chapter 1. And notice there, Colossians chapter 1, verse 18. And he is the head of the body, the church, who is the beginning. Verse 20. And having made peace through the blood of his cross, by him to reconcile all things. And it has to do with the heavenly. Here, the point is this in verse 20, having made peace through the blood of his cross. Don't violate that peace. Don't live as though there is a middle wall of partition. Don't live as though God still recognizes national and ethnic favor towards any one group of people. In God's sight, there is no ethnic, racial, religious, national distinctions today. So, is it possible for someone who is a member of the church of the body of Christ to be guilty of the blood of Christ? Yeah, you live a life that violates the very thing God says is true. And when we treat each other with this attitude of, and we're going to see superiority over others that are treated with an attitude of inferiority. Okay, go back to 1 Corinthians chapter 11. 1 Corinthians chapter 11. So, again, being guilty. And if we notice again, chapter 11, 1 Corinthians chapter 11, and notice again there, verse 29. For he that eateth and drinketh unworthily, eateth and drinketh damnation, notice, to himself. It's not God damning a member of the body of Christ. How dare you? You ate that cracker and you have unconfessed sin. And now I'm going to pronounce damnation to that unrepentant sinner. Is that the language? No, wait a minute. You know what happens when I live a life unbecoming of my identity as a member of the body of Christ by way of my treatment towards you? I'm eating and drinking damnation to myself. We'll see that in just a second. I'm living like an amputee. Now, that sounds like, what are you talking about, living like an amputee? Are we members one of another? And we'll see that again in just a second, chapter 12. So when I take before you, I've severed myself from that relationship I'm supposed to enjoy with the body of Christ. The body of Christ demands that we care one for another. But if in my own selfish, self-loving, self-centered way, choose to defy who I am with you, I'm just damning myself. I separate myself from you. And is that a good thing or a bad thing? We'll look at the word damnation. That sounds like a harsh word. But in the context, Paul in Romans already tells us what he means by eating and drinking damnation. Before we get to that, the end of verse 29, not discerning the Lord's what? Not his biological body that hung there on the cross. What body has Paul been emphasizing beginning in chapter 10? We're the one body. Now, there's something interesting here. Go to John chapter 13. For our brothers who will argue, oh no, that's Judas. Well, you know, there's something in light of what Judas did do that kind of parallels what we potentially can do one with another. Judas did betray the Lord Jesus. Can I betray you as a member of the body of Christ? Can you betray me as a member of the body of Christ? Well, now, that's kind of interesting here, interesting thing that we'll look at. In John chapter 13, look at verse 18. Now, yes, the Lord Jesus Christ, he's going to identify the one who's going to betray him, right? John chapter 13 and verse 18. I speak not of you all, I knew whom I have chosen, but that the scripture may be fulfilled. He that eateth bread with me hath lifted up his heel against me. Now, historically, this is Judas. But this is just an appalling thing that's happening here. Go over to Psalms chapter 41. Go to Psalms chapter 41. He has lit the guy. I'm eating with this guy. He's at my table. It's the Lord's table, by the way. And the guy, he's sharing a meal with me. And you know, the other passages, the guy who dips the bread into the sop, that's the betrayer, okay? He's lifted up his heel against me. Now, in Psalms chapter 41, in describing whom we now know is Judas. Notice how Psalms in chapter 41, verse 9. Psalms 41, verse 9. Yea, mine own familiar friend, in whom I trusted, which did eat of my bread, hath lifted up his heel against me. You know what? Now, obviously, John chapter 13 is a quote from this verse, right? Jesus is saying, the guy that I'm eating with him. Isn't it supposed to be a meal shared together based upon love, charity, value, esteem, honor? He's sitting right next to me, and he's lifting his heel up. You notice here in verse 9, what is he called in verse 9? Yea, mine own familiar what? My friend. Now, I just want you to think about, you know, if we're engaged in an unworthily treating one another, violating the spiritual meaning and significance of the bread and the cup, and I'm not discerning the Lord's body, you know, I can do what Judas did. That's a betrayal of the Lord. And if I betray you, remember there in 1 Corinthians, ye sin against the brethren. I'm sorry. When ye sin against the brethren, ye sin against Christ. That's pretty sobering. Go to chapter 55. Psalms chapter 55. Psalms 55. And look there at verse 12. Psalms chapter 55 and verse 12. For it was not an enemy that reproached me. Then I could have borne it. Neither was it he that hated me that did magnify himself against me. Then I would have hid myself from him. But it was thou, a man mine equal, my guide and my acquaintance. We took sweet counsel together and walked unto the house of God in company. Let death seize upon them and let them go down quick into hell, for wickedness is in their dwellings and among them. You understand exactly what verse 12 and verse 13 is describing, right? You know what? If there was a blatant antagonist who hated me with iron passion, you know what? If you reproach me, I could handle that. But what happens when it's one whom you view as a friend? One, a man mine equal. You know, it hurts when it should hurt when a member of the body of Christ would treat another member as unworthily as Judas treated the Lord Jesus Christ, whom the Lord said, that was my friend, mine equal. Now, equal in what sense? Historically, they were equal in the sense of they were conducting the Father's work. They were carrying out the Father's ministry, the Father's business, if you will. Judas was right there. In fact, who held the money bag? I think about Mike all the time. Mike Wilkie, our treasurer. Every Sunday night, he's got a money bag. And I think, there's Judas. No, I don't. I don't think that. I think, my friend, mine equal. But so, now, wait a minute. You don't normally entrust, you know, the money bag with someone with questionable character, right? Hey, there's our friend. He's an equal. So it's kind of interesting. Go back to 1 Corinthians chapter 11. It's kind of interesting that when you do read about not discerning the Lord's body, not viewing yourself in relationship to the body whole. And when I betray you, I am literally a spiritual amputee. I am severing myself from that identity as members with you, one body. I live for myself, I'm an amputee. I care about myself, I'm an amputee. If I'm consumed with my own will, desires, wishes, and self-advancement, I've just severed myself from the body. And how many of us go around cutting off parts of our body because we don't like it? Did you hear about, there's something called the zombie drug. Have you heard anything about that? There is a drug, I don't have any idea what this is about, nor do I want to know what this drug, it's called a zombie drug. There's some sort of drug out there on the street. People, this guy, you know what he did this week? He was on the zombie drug, and he sawed his own leg off. This is weird stuff. Whatever this drug does, they're cutting, this guy cut his leg off. Now, that's not normal. But you know, when I view you as my inferior, or I view myself as your superior, you know what I just did? I just committed amputation. I cut my relationship off with you. Okay, and that's a pretty sobering. And as a result of that, Paul tells us that, let's go look back there, 1 Corinthians chapter 9, chapter 11, verse 29. 1 Corinthians 11, verse 29. For he that eateth and drinketh unworthily eateth and drinketh damnation. Now look what happens. What is the consequence of that? To himself. Now go over to Romans chapter 14, and here we go. The word damnation, unworthily, unworthy manner, guilty. Yes, in the sense of we commit wrongdoing. I am guilty of doing wrong. I am violating our relationship. So guilt is not a dirty word, and that doesn't mean you're going to hell. You see, why do people hijack the terminology and ascribe meaning to it that it really doesn't have? To be guilty means you did something wrong. Remember when Peter was to be blamed? Remember Paul in Galatians chapter 2, and Peter saw and perceived the grace that was given to the Apostle Paul. In other words, Peter understood an entire dispensational change has taken place. And as a result of that change, there is no more Jew and Gentile, no more circumcision and uncircumcision. Peter understood the wall is down, that there is nothing unclean. And then Peter's eating a meal with a bunch of Jews. And there was a James crew, James, a legalist. They came around, and what did Peter do? He got up from the table and separated himself from the Gentiles, violating what the gospel of grace teaches. So anyway, Peter, he separates himself from the Gentiles because in Peter's mind, he's treating the Gentiles as inferior when historically they were, but no more. So you know what Paul said? I withstood him to the face because Peter was to be blamed. Was Peter guilty? Now, wait a minute. He was to be blamed. Oh, no. Did Peter lose his soul? Is Peter now consigned to an eternity in hell? No. But wait a minute. Peter, you did something wrong. And by the way, Who's the one that corrected the bad behavior and doctrine that legalism produces? Paul's the answer. Peter's a wonderful representation. Peter typifies what the law does, and the law will continually separate, biting and devouring, like a bunch of animals gnawing at each other. You know, Paul's the answer to that. Just like the answer to Peter's failure and blameworthiness. By the way, to be blamed means you didn't walk according to truth. If you or I do not walk according to the truth, are we guilty of walking wrongly? See, the word guilty in of itself just simply means you did something wrong. It does not mean you're banished for all of eternity. So the word damnation, Romans chapter 14. Wait a minute, Paul already tells us what he means when a member of the body brings damnation to himself. This is not God pronouncing damnation. But what I do in relationship to you, if it's wrong, I'm bringing damnation to myself. Notice in Romans chapter 14, the entire context in Romans chapter 14 has to do with this relationship that exists between members of the body of Christ. Look there at verse 20, Romans chapter 14, verse 20. For meat destroy not the work of God. Verse 22, hast thou faith? Have it to thyself before God. Happy is he that condemneth, again, not himself. This isn't God doing the condemning. Can my behavior bring condemnation to myself? That's what Paul's talking about. In the thing which he alloweth, and he that doubteth is damned if he eat. Wait a minute. Because he eateth not of faith. For whatsoever is not of faith is sin. So Paul, when we read the word damnation, we already learned some things in Romans chapter 14. When I violate my identity with you, and you're a weak brother, I'm a strong brother. I'm a weak brother, you're a strong brother. And we begin to attack, and we begin to receive one another to doubtful disputations. We're beginning to fight and to wrangle. And now I'm on the verge of potentially destroying your edifice and vice versa. Wait a minute. If I'm engaged in the context, eating of meats, isn't that interesting? What's the problem at Corinth? It begins in 1 Corinthians chapter 8 with eating meats offered unto idols. Paul, he brings it back up in 1 Corinthians chapter 10, and he talks about meats that are offered unto idols, the devil's table and the devil's cup, and you know, a bunch of vampires and cannibals and so on and so forth. So in chapter 11, now wait a minute, it has to do with eating. So verse 22, hast thou faith? Have it to thyself before God. Happy is he that condemneth not himself in the thing which he alloweth. In other words, eat the meat in clear conscience. You have a brother who understands. I can eat chicken, which was offered to the Indian goddess Kali. And I did eat chicken, offered to the Indian goddess Kali. There was an Indian restaurant on Devon and Western, Johnny Vargas, he took us there, right? Took me there. And the first thing Johnny said was, there was, what do you call that red chicken? What was that? Yes, tambourine? Tambourine. And so Johnny said, he said, you know that this chicken was offered to a god, goddess. And he kind of looked at me, said, you got a problem with it? I said, you have a problem with it? No. I said, let's enjoy. So, you know what? Happy is he that condemneth not himself in that thing which he alloweth. Well, Paul's talking about, can you eat that meat with clear conscience? Yes. Be happy. Now notice, he that condemneth not himself. Now wait a minute, what if my conscience isn't built up enough? Okay, I can eat chicken offered to the goddess Kali on Devon and Western. I'll go there again. Good restaurant. But I've been to Catholic funerals. And Catholic funerals. Where they now, at the end of that funeral service, they adore the host by way of this sacred mystery, you know, the whole thing, transubstantiation. I will never Now, let me ask you, if you went to a Catholic church, funeral, mass, I hope you don't go to mass, and the guy up there with the funny clown suit, he says, with the funny hat, he says, "Hey, Al, why don't you eat this rice wafer?" Of course, they don't call it a rice wafer. You understand that. Can I ask you a question? If I ate that wafer and drank out of that cup, is my position in Jesus Christ now compromised? Do I lose my salvation? Do I lose my identity in Christ? But you know, I'll never do it. I cannot with clear conscience. That happened in India back in 1999. We were invited to a big church group there. Anyway, they wanted to do communion. At the time in 99, okay, I didn't have quite a problem with it. But then Dan, he said, "Hey, guys, understand this. This denomination, they believe in consubstantiation." You know, at the time, we used to do the whole, you know, cup, juice and cup, cracker stuff. And I thought, oh, why not? When he said they believe in consubstantiation, they don't believe that it's literally transformed, but rather Christ's presence, I couldn't do it. I could not do it. So what Paul is saying, verse 23, "And he that doubteth," you know what? I'm at that funeral, and you have this whole line of Catholics. They're waiting in line to eat like cannibals, which I could have eaten it. And God, and you know what? I'm still in Christ. Meats are nothing to God. In fact, that's the whole argument here, right? Meats for the belly and belly for the meats. My relationship is not compromised if I eat that stupid rice wafer, even if some clown says it's literally Jesus' flesh. You know, is God going to love me less? No. He still loves me just the same. But I got a problem with it for me. I can't do that. So verse 23, "And he that doubteth is damned if he eat, because he eateth not of what? Faith." So it's self-reflection here. The word damnation has nothing to do with eternal loss. It has everything to do with your conscience. Can you do it clearly? Without violating the principles and the standards and the beliefs and the convictions that you have developed. And if you violate your own conscience, if you doubt, listen, whatsoever is not of faith is what? Sin. So go back to 1 Corinthians 11. I was really hoping to finish this chapter. So let's go for just a minute here. 1 Corinthians chapter 11. So we have an idea, I hope, verse 29, "For he that eateth and drinketh unworthily eateth and drinketh damnation to himself." Man, why would you impose that kind of sentence to yourself? Wait a minute, why are you dividing yourself away from the body, from the Lord's body? Look at verse 30. "For this cause many are weak and sickly among you, and many sleep." Okay. That's, again, not challenging language and different ideas of what's going on. But once again, has Paul said some things about being weak or being sickly or falling asleep? Go back to Romans chapter 14. Look there in Romans chapter 14. In Romans chapter 14. Well, "If my behavior is anything but the spiritual reality that should exist in my relationship to you, my attitude towards you, my behavior towards you, it actually violates some things here. And Romans chapter 14, verse 1, "Him that is weak in the what?" So wait a minute. "Receive ye, but not to doubt." And so you know what Paul does from this point on? He starts dealing with the expectations that grace imposes upon the stronger brother towards the weak brother. So let me condense it this way. The warning in chapter 14 is, listen, you who are strong, you need to be sensitive to the one who is weak. Weak in the faith, not because they're not weak in character, not because they're flawed, weak because they don't understand yet. So wait, you're at Corinth, and you have individuals, go over to 1 Corinthians chapter 12. You have individuals that know better, but They exercise their liberty at the expense of one who is weak in the faith. And as a consequence, look there at 1 Corinthians chapter 11 before we go to chapter 12. 1 Corinthians chapter 11. And notice there at verse 22. Look at verse 22. What? Have ye not houses to eat and drink in, or despise ye the church of God and shame them? You know what it means to shame someone? I mean, the dictionary definition means to mock, to deride, to dishonor, to disgrace, disdain, reproach. So here's the one who takes before the other. And you know what I'm going to do? I'm going to muscle my way in. Chapter 12, look at verse 15 for just. So you have the guy that cuts in the front of the line, having no empathy for the other brother. Why would someone think it's owed them to eat first? Look at verse 15 of 1 Corinthians chapter 12. If the foot shall say, because I am not the what? Hand. Now, just understand the dynamic here. If I muscle my way through and I flaunt my liberty, I flaunt my maybe deluded sense of spiritual superiority, what could happen to the weak brother? You know what the weak brother begins to do? For this cause many are what? Weak in the faith. They begin to adopt a spirit of inferiority. In other words, if the foot, why is Paul writing this? If the foot shall say, because I am not the hand, I am not of the body. There are individuals at Corinth who literally have this complex. You've heard the inferiority complex? They think, well, I'm not the hand. I'm just the foot. I'm really not a part of the body, am I? I guess I have to grow until I can become a part of the body. Or I'm going to have to grow so that I can better relate. You see what Paul's warning against? Their behavior was reducing individuals to this sense of spiritual inferiority. They were weak, not so much in the sense of malnourishment. People assume that that's what Paul's talking about. You eat before the guy that doesn't have, well, they're suffering malnutrition, and now they're sick, and now they're going to die. Spiritually, Paul doesn't use that language in that way. Yeah, how dare you, how dare I, for sake of illustration, you know, muscle my way. And David, you know what? You take a back seat. And then David starts to think, well, I'm not like that guy. Because I'm the foot and I'm not the hand. Verse 16. And if the ear shall say, because I am not the eye, I am not of the body. Is it therefore not of the body? Why would a Corinthian convince themselves, I might not be a part of this? Because I'm just the big toe. And you see all those other spiritual powerhouses and you know what? The spiritual powerhouse is the first one to act like the big toe and to value and esteem the other as though they're the ones that are worthy. You see what? The Lord's Supper has everything to do with that spirit. And the Corinthians are completely violating that, all right? Okay, next week, I do want to talk a little bit more about that. Sick. Can you be physically sick? Yeah. Infirmed? Can you be spiritually sick? That's what Paul's talking about. Father, we do again thank you for your love and for your grace. Again, may we never be guilty of violating the very essence of what it means to be one bread, one body. May we, with a heart and a mind of selflessness, just desire to esteem others first, to look on others, the things of others before our own things. And Father, we just pray that we would be an accurate reflection of what it means to be members one of another. And may we not be found guilty in the unworthy way in which we might treat one another. We again thank you for your word, and we certainly thank you for this glorious relationship that you created, this one new man, this new creature, where we literally are dependent upon one another. We need one another, and you've tempered the body in such a way that it's designed to tenderly care one for another with a spirit and an attitude of forgiveness and tenderheartedness and a heart of compassion, a love that truly is active and willingly engaged. And Lord, may we learn what that means as we continue studying the book of 1 Corinthians. And we ask in Christ Jesus' name, amen.